That was the locks and the condition variables. But this very classic concurrency control that can actually easily do what the locks and the condition variables do, and then so can do everything else also. So all concurrency control could be done with this classic semaphores. So semaphores, they're from the 60s already, so they are the granddaddy of all these other concurrency control techniques. So sometimes in some particular situations we wanna think in a level of a different abstraction, but the semaphore, despite its deceptive simplicity, so how powerful it is, once you understand how it works, so then there's an online book, if you're interested, a little book of semaphores that is worth reading if you're interested in that kind of stuff. And then of course any operating system and the concurrency course is gonna be discussing this. And then one more advantage, the same with the regular expressions, that if you learn this once, so whenever there's concurrency, there's gonna be semaphores, that then you have the knowledge there already, just have to learn the syntax and other things in the new system. So this semaphore, it's not much more than, actually this is like an atomic integer with that is restricted to behave differently for negative values. But I cannot fault anybody looking at this, seeing what is the point, like what does this achieve in anything. So what is a semaphore? So it's an integer counter. You can't even do integer arithmetic to it. So there is just the increment and the decrement operations. So conceptually, we say that the integer value, we think of it that the semaphore has a number of permits that it can give out, but the permit is just a thinking concept, so there is no permit class or a permit object. We just say that the semaphore that has the value 5, we think that it has 5 permits available to give out. And then the public interface, so needs 2 operations, and then, of course, the best implementation in the Java standard library, so there is other handy operations, but in the classic formulation, so these 2 are needed. So one is the increment, one is the decrement. So you acquire a permit to yourself, so asking semaphore, give me a permit. And if the semaphore the value is greater than 0, so then that gets decremented, and you receive, so this method returns. So the fact that this method returns means you got your permit. And this is guaranteed to happen atomically, that if somebody else in parallel is asking a permit for the same semaphore, so if there is a permit, exactly one of you will get it. And if there is several permits, so then you all get the one atomistically. But it cannot be that if there is one permit that you both get it, or that neither one of you gets it. So acquire this permit done atomically, and then the increment, so where you can release a permit back to the system. But this permit is just a thinking tool. So a very important thing to understand about the semaphores is that it has no concept of an owner. So a lock is, the idea is that only the owner of the lock can unlock it. So call the method unlock to the lock that is not in your position, you get another illegal state exception thrown in your face. But the semaphore, so this depends on the discipline, how your program uses the semaphore. So then analogy to the lock, that the lock can only work if it's properly attached to the door. If you put the lock and inside your kitchen cabinet, so it's not gonna stop anybody in there. So the semaphore, its power to do things, so depends on the fact that the logic of your code uses the semaphore to do the thing. So the semaphore, it has no concept of an owner, that anybody can at any time acquire or release. So some of these mechanisms to use a semaphore, they depend on the fact that suppose semaphore initially has a value 0, no permits to give in, and then somebody wants the permission to go through, so they call acquire, and this will block as long as there is no permission. And then some other party who is giving out the permission. So when they have the permission to give, then they call release. And now, unlike a signal in a condition variable from a previous video, this release, so this increases the permit count. It doesn't vanish even if nobody at the moment needs to have a permit. So then if the release happens before the acquire, so then the acquire immediately succeeds because there is the one permit available. And now we realize that the mutex lock is just a special case of a semaphore in that you initialize that semaphore to be one. And then at the beginning of the critical section, instead of the mutex lock, you put the semaphore acquire, and on the way out, instead of the mutex unlock, you put the semaphore release. So where semaphore with the initial value 1 used this way, so does the work of mutex lock. But the semaphore is more flexible. It can have any initial value, positive, negative, zero. Even the negative values that the semaphore comes to the world owing some permits, that's a perfectly legit solution to a problem that we'll see later today. So all these initial values are meaningful. And suppose you have a semaphore that you use as a mutex. What happens if you give it the initial value bigger than 1? So let's say 5. So then it enforces as a doorman, as a discipline, that at most 5 clients can be inside the store at the same time. So if the 6th one tries to come in, so then that one doesn't receive the permission because the permission count is 0. Acquire blocks until one of the customer leaves, releases a permit, and then the next guy gets in. So this, the special case of this one is kind of like, is known as the turnstile. So that okay, that's actually a slightly different thing. So all that terminology is there in the little book of semaphores. But the semaphores, so these are highly flexible, that we're gonna be solving problems with the semaphores. And now, this is the idea, and like I said, the best implementations there in the standard library. So we don't need to reinvent the wheels ourselves. So lots of wheels have lots of edge cases that we cannot prepare, cannot come bite us in the worst moment. So the advantage of methods in the standard library, even though whoever wrote the methods, they didn't have any superhuman powers, is the fact that the standard library methods, they're being pummeled from all around the world. Everybody is using them to do different things. So any weakness, any bug inside them is gonna manifest soon enough. So even all the edge cases, somebody's gonna hit them. So the standard library methods, they have been tested over their existence with the giant pummeling. So at least they don't have any obvious bugs inside them. But now the semaphore, we can implement it as practice. And this now allows me to demonstrate the use of the mutexes and use of the condition variables. So now, standard exercise in the operating system concurrency course. So you have locks and condition variables, make a semaphore, and you have a semaphore, make locks and condition variables. So all of these are equally powerful. They can all simulate each other. We aid it with some Java programming language logic outside. So what is a semaphore? Let's call it my semaphore to make sure that we don't get an accidental clash there. So it contains a number of permits. So now there's at most 2 billion permits, otherwise it's gonna overflow. Hopefully that kind of situation doesn't realize. And there has to be a condition variable. So name your condition variable after the things that are being waited for. So waiting for a permit to become available, so condition permit available. And you cannot have a lock outside a critical section, and these are critical sections anyway. So if the semaphore has one permit and two clients ask for a permission in parallel, so exactly one of them will get it. So we need a mutual exclusion for sure. And the construction, so the number of permits initially, again, any integer value is a meaningful and legitimate starting value. And we can make the mutex, so the lock can be fair so fair actually means less than what is promised here in the theory of concurrency. Fair just means that you don't have to wait forever. So stronger version of fairness, FIFO, that the first come, first served. Then we can make the semaphore fairness from the fairness of the underlying log, but we gotta realize, so this technique doesn't generalize that the fairness of the entire system doesn't follow from the fairness of its individual parts. So fairness as a property does not propagate upwards. So a system made of fair components might still produce starvation. And we need a condition variable. Notice the mechanism to create the condition variable. We don't say new as a keyword, but the mutex, the log objects, have a method to create the new condition. They are new here as a part of the name, not as the operator. So that's the initial state of the semaphore. The public interface, so here I've implemented just the two classics. So the standard library, you can look at it, has several useful methods, and then also the fail fast and the blocking variations and the timeout variations of acquire. So acquire is supposed to block until there's a permit available. So the fact that the call returns means you receive the permit. This method will not return until the permit is there. And how do we recognize methods that are blocking? From the fact that they throw interrupted exception when they are forced awake. So the caller can distinguish that you acquired properly or whether you are forced awake. So to enter the critical section, lock the mutex and make sure in a finally block that the mutex gets unlocked no matter what. And then in the try block, we have the critical section here. So the condition to wait is that there is at least one permit. The while not condition, so while there is less than one permit, while loop, remember, in all languages, while you have not reached the condition, do one more round. So go to sleep inside the condition variable. Eventually you get out. If it was a false alarm, go back to sleep. But once you get through this point, and knowing that you're the only thread currently operating in the critical section, so between these two statements, the while and the permit decrement, the permit cannot be yoinked away, like in a Simpsons, so yoink, somebody comes, takes the permit, like the Homer was trying to eat it, and then it was yoinked away. So we can use that mental image here to think about this. But since we have written, We recognized all the critical sections, so we know for a fact that nobody else can be decrementing permits between here. So now we can decrement the permit. The permits is gonna be greater than zero. Now we could assert it if we wanted, but it doesn't prove it because context which could happen between the assert and decrement. So then somebody could theoretically yoink it out, but then doesn't hurt to have the assert. Maybe I'll leave it in here. That at least sometimes this might catch as something good. Nothing sadder in life than a commented out assertion. Well, there's sadder things as we know, but I'm being lyrical. Release, notice release is part of the same critical section. This is not obvious, but it is so, because the chance that if somebody's acquiring while you're releasing, that you signal before the other guy goes to await. So we have to ensure that nobody's inside the acquire critical section while we are doing this. So in these two methods, even though they're separate, notice they're part of the same critical section. Therefore, it's the same mutex. There is two doors in, and both have the same mutex, and there is two doors out, and they have the same unlock. Now, does it follow that this is fair from the fairness of the lock? It's not automatic, so you can think about it, and think of a scenario where if thinking that this is not the critical section, let's comment out the lock and unlock from here. So the rare but possible situation that is a race condition.